In the last session, I discussed about the optical sources and coupling. In this module, I'll be explaining about fiber optic receiver and measurements. These are the topics: fundamental receiver operation, pre-amplifiers, fiber attenuation measurement, dispersion measurement, refractive index profile measurement, cutoff wavelength measurement, numerical aperture measurement, and fiber diameter measurement. Let me discuss now. What is the function of a fiber optic receiver? Fiber optic receiver accepts the optical signal from the transmitting end and converts them into electrical signal. This diagram shows the basic components of an optical receiver. The first element is the photodetector, which can be either a pin diode or an avalanche photodiode. This photodiode produces an electric current that is proportional to the received power level. Since this electric current produced here is very weak, an amplifier is needed to increase the strength of the signal. The amplifier used here is called the front-end amplifier, or it can also be called as a pre-amplifier. And then the low pass filter used here is to filter the noise or to reduce the noise that is outside the signal bandwidth. The equalizer is used to reshape the pulses to minimize the inter-symbol interference. The sampling circuit samples the signal level at the midpoint of each time slot. The decision circuit decides whether the received signal is either a bit 1 or a 0 depending upon the threshold level. If the received signal level is greater than the threshold level, a 1 is assumed to have been received. Or else if the voltage is below the threshold level, then a 0 is assumed to have been received. To determine this bit interpretation, the receiver must know the bit boundaries. This is done with the help of the clock recovery circuit. Next, we shall see what are the pre-amplifiers or front-end amplifiers. There are three different types of front-end amplifiers or pre-amplifiers, called as low impedance amplifier, high impedance amplifier, and trans-impedance amplifiers. Noise sources at the front end of a receiver normally dominate the sensitivity and the bandwidth. So the front-end amplifiers are used to increase the sensitivity of the receivers. The low impedance amplifier is the most straightforward one. The basic structure is shown here in the diagram. This is the low impedance amplifier. It has got an effective input resistance RA and a bias resistor RB in parallel with RA. So the total load resistance RL is given as RA into RB divided by RA plus RB. That is, RA is connected in parallel to RB. A small load resistance yields a larger bandwidth. But the thermal noise is inversely proportional to the load resistance. So the value of RL should be as large as possible to minimize the thermal noise. Thus, by increasing the value of RB, the high impedance amplifier design can be achieved. For a high impedance front end amplifier, a high load resistance results in low noise but also gives a low receiver bandwidth. Although equalizers can be implemented to increase the bandwidth, if the bandwidth is very less than the bitrate, then such a front end amplifier cannot be used. So in order to overcome this, the trans impedance amplifier design came into existence. It overcomes the drawbacks of high impedance amplifier. This diagram shows the trans impedance amplifier. In this case, RL is used as a negative feedback resistor around an inverting amplifier. Now, RL can be large since a negative feedback reduces the effective resistance seen by the photodiode by a factor of G, such that RP is equal to RL divided by G plus 1, where G is the gain of the amplifier. So when compared to high impedance design, the trans impedance amplifier bandwidth increases by a factor of G plus 1 for the same load resistance. Although this increases the thermal noise, compared to high impedance amplifier, this increase usually is less than a factor of 2 and can easily be tolerated. To start with fiber attenuation measurement, there are two different types, cutback technique and insertion loss method. Let me talk about cutback technique first. The white light source shown here may be a xenon arc lamp or halogen lamp as shown here. This is focused on to the lens and chopper arrangement, and then it is given to the lock-in amplifier for phase sensitive detection. Next, a monochromator device is used, which is used for selecting the required wavelength at which the attenuation is to be measured. Actually, white light source consists of many different wavelengths, so this monochromator will select the required wavelength. Then the light is made to fall on the filter and beam splitter. Beam splitter is used for splitting the signal into transmitted light and reflected light. Then objective lens is used for magnification, and then it is given to the mode scrambler. The mode scrambling device is a device which is used for getting uniform distribution of power. Then it goes on to the cladding mode stripper, which is used for selecting only fundamental mode of power. That is, mode stripper, the fiber end is used to remove any optical power that can be scattered from the core into the cladding. So it will select only the fundamental mode and it will allow it into the fiber. Then the light rays are passed into the fiber, and the photo detector accepts this light rays and converts it into electrical signal. The photo detector used here may be pin or avalanche photodiode, and it is usually indexed matched to the fiber output using a epoxy resin or index matching gel. Then the attenuation per unit length, represented as alpha in decibels, can be obtained using the formula alpha dB is equal to 10 divided by L1 minus L2 log to the base 10 PON by PO2. Actually, the fiber is cut off a few meters from the source and the output power is measured. Initially, the transmission loss, in order to find the transmission loss, the optical power is first measured at the output end of the fiber. Then the fiber is cut off a few meters from the source and the output power is measured. And the values are substituted in this formula in order to get the attenuation loss. Here, L1 denotes the original length of the fiber. L2 denotes the length of the fiber after it has been cut off. PON is the output power at the near end, and PO2 is the output power at the far end. So using this formula, the attenuation in decibels can be calculated. But there are certain drawbacks in this cutback technique. One is, it cannot be used for cables with connectors. That is, if two or more cables are joined with the help of the connectors, then this cutback technique method of measurement of attenuation cannot be followed. Hence, insertion loss method, which is the next type, is followed. This is the experimental setup for insertion loss method. Here, the launch and the detector couplings are made through the connectors like this. Here, first of all, the connector of short length launching fiber is attached to the connector of the receiving system, and the power level P1 of lambda is recorded. Next, P2 of lambda is recorded by connecting the cable to be tested between the launching system and the receiving system. Then by substituting P1 of lambda and P2 of lambda in this formula, the attenuation can be calculated. Next is the dispersion measurement. Here there are two different types, time domain dispersion and frequency domain dispersion measurement. I'll be starting with time domain measurement first. As you can see in this diagram, whenever any light pulses travel along the fiber, its pulse width gets broadened. Here an impulse, as you know, the impulse doesn't have any pulse width. If it is given to any system, that is a fiber optic system, the system considered here is a fiber optic cable. At the output end of the fiber optic cable, the pulse gets broadened like this. So this broadening effect is due to the overlapping of pulses as the light rays travel along the fiber because of inter-symbol interference. So this inter-symbol interference in turn reduces the information carrying capacity of the fiber. This sort of broadening of pulses in time domain is called as time domain dispersion. And the output power P out of T as a function of time is calculated, or it is given by the formula H of T, which is impulse response, in convolution with the input P in of T. The experimental setup is shown here. The light from the laser source driven by the pulse driver is given to the beam splitter. The beam splitter is used for splitting the input signal into transmitted light and reflecting light in terms of splitting ratio. And the signal at the output of the beam splitter is passed to the variable diaphragm, or you can say the mode scrambler can also be used. Mode scrambling device can also be used. And it is passed to the fiber here. One end of the fiber under test is connected to this part, that is variable diaphragm followed by lens. And the other end is connected to the photodiode. And the photodiode output is connected to the sampling oscilloscope. At the output, the photo detector measures P out of F. This P out of F is measured here. And the input signal is input optical signal is made to fall on this avalanche photodiode. And it converts the input signal into input optical signal into electrical signal, and that is fed directly to the sampling oscilloscope. So the variable delay, that is the delay between the original signal and the signal after it passes through the fiber, is compared here, and the output is measured. Next is dispersion measurement in frequency domain. Here the same setup is used as before, except the sampling oscilloscope. Here instead of sampling oscilloscope, a spectrum analyzer is used here. Input P in here is then measured by replacing the test fiber with a short reference fiber, and then the output is P out of F is measured. And the Fourier transform of H of T is given by H of F, that is equivalent to P out of F divided by P in of F, where P out of F is the output power measured and out of the photodetector, and P in of F is the input power. You can show, see the waveform here. The optical bandwidth or the fiber bandwidth is defined as the lowest frequency at which the H of F decreases or reduces to 0.5. This is the optical bandwidth. Fiber refractive index profile measurement. Refractive index profile of the fiber is an important parameter that determines the characteristics of optical fibers. Using this measurement, numerical aperture of the fiber, number of modes propagating within the core, can be measured. Actually, there are two different methods used for measurement of refractive index profile. One is called the Mach-Zehnder method, which is based on transmitted light. The other one is called the Michelson method, which is based on the reflected light. We'll see Mach-Zehnder method now. The experimental setup is shown here. Actually, light from the laser source is made to fall on the beam splitter. The beam splitter's function I have already explained. Its main function is to split the incoming light rays into transmitted light beam and reflected light beam depending on the splitting ratio. Two mirrors M1 and M2 are used here. You can see mirror M1 and M2. Mirror M1 is used for reflecting the transmitted beam towards the fiber slab here like this, and the other mirror is used for reflecting the reflected beam from the beam splitter to be viewed through the microscope here. The optical rays from M1 are passed through the fiber slab here. This is a sample of fiber slab. The sample of fiber taken here should be polished at both ends to obtain smooth and optically flat surface. Then the slab is immersed in index matching fluid and then it is examined through the electronic microscope. Since the refractive index is inversely proportional to density of the materials, the density of the core fiber varies, as you all know. So the light traces different paths of different wavelengths. This can be observed using the electronic microscope here. Phase of the incident light through the mirror M2 is compared with the phase of the emerging light from the slab via mirror M1. The interference fringe pattern, as shown in this diagram here, this sort of interference or fringe pattern can be observed through microscope. And the fringe displacement Q, if there is any fringe displacement, that displacement is called as Q, that occurs due to the variation in density of the core material, that can be noted. And it is given by the refractive index difference is given by the expression delta N is equal to Q lambda by X. Here Q is the fringe shift, lambda is the incident optical wavelength, X is the thickness of the fiber slab, and del N is a refractive index difference. And the graph is plotted with the core radius along x-axis and del N along y-axis. The values of del N, as you can see from this diagram, can be obtained from this graph. And from this graph, it is noted that the profile obtained here of the sample of fiber is a graded index profile. Then advantages and disadvantages of mixed gender interferometer are listed out here. That there are two advantages. One is, using this method, the measurement made will be accurate. Then the detailed knowledge on refractive index profile is obtained. Coming to disadvantages, computation is tedious here in this method. Then more time is required to prepare the sample of slab. Next method is refractive index profile measurement using near field scanning method. Near field scanning method determines the refractive index from intensity distribution. Here Lambertian source, that is LED or tungsten source, is used as a light source here. Light rays from this source is coupled into the fiber. The objective lens used in this experimental setup magnifies the image of the incoming light rays and couples it into the fiber via the chopper. Chopper is used to cut the light rays into smaller parts so that a small portion of it can be fed into the photodetector. Photodetector used is here is a transversely mounted photodetector so that the maximum power is detected along the core axis, and the power slightly decreases as the light rays move at a radius r away from the core axis. Then the output from photodetector is amplified by the combination of this optical chopper and the lock-in amplifier shown here in this diagram. Then the near field optical path density at the core axis, indicated by PD of 0, this is the expression for near field optical path density. And the near field optical path density at radius r is denoted by PD of r. This can be plotted using XY recorder. The refractive index is calculated using this expression, PD of r divided by PD of 0 is equal to C r, z into n1 square of r minus n2 square divided by n1 square of 0 minus n2 square, where PD of r is the optical path density at radius r from the core axis, PD of 0 is optical path density at core axis exactly, C of r, z is the correction factor, n1 of 0 is the refractive index of fiber axis, and n1 of r is the refractive index at distance r from the fiber axis. You can see the graph here. This graph shows the refractive index profile of step index fiber measured using near field scanning method. This is for a practical step index fiber. And coming to advantages and disadvantages. Advantages are, it is a straightforward method and it is a rapid technique. Disadvantages are, implementing the correction factor C of R, Z is quite time consuming, and mode coupling differential mode attenuation can lead to error in measurements. Then the next method is refractive index profile measurement using end reflection method. Refractive index at any point in a cross-section of optical fiber is related to reflected power from the fiber surface at the point based on Fresnel reflection formula given like this as shown here. R is equal to reflected optical power divided by incident optical power, where N1 here is the refractive index at a point on fiber surface. The experimental setup is shown here. The laser beam is directed through a polarizer and a lambda by 4 plate to prevent a feedback of reflected optical power. Circularly polarized light from lambda by 4 plate is filtered and expanded to provide a suitable spot size. The function of the beam splitter here, as I have explained before, is to split the incoming rays into transmitted signal and the reflected signal depending on the splitting ratio. Index matching oil, as shown here, is applied. Index matching liquid or oil is applied at a measured phase. The laser beam incident on the polarizer is deflected vertically using a mirror. This oil immersion objective is utilized to focus beam onto the immersed fiber end. Coming to disadvantages, fiber alignment is necessary here and fiber end phase should be flat, else it can cause reflections. Fiber cutoff wavelength measurement. A multimode fiber has many cutoff wavelengths because the number of bound propagating modes is usually large. The number of guided modes is given by the equation Mg is equal to pi a by lambda the whole square into n1 square minus n2 square. Here a is the core radius, n1 is the refractive index of the core medium, and n2 is the refractive index of the cladding medium. The configurations for single turn and split mandrel type is shown below. In the bending reference technique, the power PS of lambda transmitted through the fiber sample is measured as a function of wavelength. PS of lambda shown here corresponds to total power, and the smaller transmitted power PB of lambda is also measured. This PB of lambda corresponds to the fundamental mode power. The bend attenuator AB of lambda, which is nothing but the difference between total power and the fundamental power, is calculated as AB of lambda is equal to 10 log to the base 10 PS of lambda divided by PB of lambda. And a graph is plotted with wavelength along the x-axis and bend attenuation along y-axis. And the effective cutoff wavelength lambda CE is determined from the graph, which is nothing but the longest wavelength at which bend attenuation AB of lambda equals 0.1 dB. Next is measurement of numerical aperture. Numerical aperture is an important optical fiber parameter which determines the light gathering capability of optical fiber. This in turn can be used for determining the normalized frequency and the number of modes propagating within the fiber. The numerical aperture is given by the formula Na is equal to sine theta a, that is equal to root of n1 square minus n2 square for step index fiber, and Na is equal to sine theta a, that is equal to root of n1 square of r minus n2 square for graded index fiber. There are two methods for measurement of numerical aperture. The first one is far field radiation pattern using scanning photo detector and rotating edge method for graded index fiber. The diagram is shown here. The fiber under test is placed in a fiber holder which is fixed in the rotating stage. This is the fiber holder as shown in the diagram. The output end of the fiber is positioned on the rotating stage with its far end parallel to the plane of the photodetector input. The photodetector is placed 10 to 20 cm from the fiber and is positioned in such a way that the maximum signal is obtained with rotation of 0 degrees as shown here in the diagram. The output power is observed and plotted as a function of angle. Then the reference signal from the optical fiber is given to the lock-in amplifier and output of photo detector is also fed to the lock-in amplifier as shown here. The lock-in amplifier only the wavelength that amplifies only the wavelength that matches with the wavelength of the reference signal. The angle at which the photodetector detects the maximum signal power is measured as the acceptance angle and is calculated using the equation n a is equal to sine theta a of x, where theta a is the acceptance angle. The next method of measurement of numerical aperture is trigonometric method for step index fiber. The experimental setup is shown here. The numerical aperture is measured by calculating the far field angle. Here in this setup, the light from the source is coupled into the optical fiber and the lens used here is needed to couple the laser beam into the core medium. The fiber under test is placed here in such a manner that the core is always at the focal point of the lens and the light at the output end of the fiber is made to fall on the screen as shown below. The screen is placed at a distance d from the output end of the fiber. So that why it is placed like that? Because so that the far field pattern of the output is obtained on the screen and the maximum optical intensity pattern on the screen A can be measured using vernier caliper. The numerical aperture is calculated using the equation n A is equal to sine theta A, that is given by A by 2. A is the distance here as shown here, divided by A by 2 the whole square plus D square the whole power half. It is simplified as A divided by A square plus 4D square the whole power half. Next is fiber diameter measurement. Here the fiber diameter measure is used here, the laser beam from the helium neon laser source is collimated using two lenses G1 and G2 and then it is reflected from two mirrors M1 and M2 as shown here. The mirror M2 is fixed to a galvanometer which makes it rotate through a small angle at a constant angular velocity. The mirror velocity is noted with the help of the galvanometer as d phi by dt. In this expression, d phi by dt is the mirror velocity. And the reflected light from mirror M2 is focused in the plane of the fiber by a lens and the shadow is made to fall on the photodetector. The velocity of the fiber shadow is noted as ds by dt. Which is directly proportional to the mirror velocity ds by dt. In this expression, ds by dt is equal to L into d phi by dt. Here, L is the distance between the mirror and the photodetector. And d phi by dt is the mirror velocity. ds by dt is the shadow velocity. The sweep circuit in this setup is used to generate a sawtooth signal which when given to the galvanometer makes the pointer to deflect. the output electrical pulse from the photodetector and the reference signal from the pulse generator are given to the op amp in order to sum these two. This summing amplifier amplifies the output pulses from the photodetector according to the reference pulses from the pulse generator, and the width of the pulse is calculated using the time interval detector. The electrical pulse width WE, as shown here, of the shadow is related to the fiber outer diameter D0, given by the expression D0 is equal to WE into DS by DT. The outer diameter of the fiber thus determined can be recorded on the printer. Optical time domain reflectometer. Optical time domain reflectometer OTDR is a powerful tool in the maintenance and installation of fiber optic system. This device is used for locating the breaks in the fiber, losses at splices and connectors, and to determine the total loss of the system from the reflected light energy. The reflected light energy may be due to Rayleigh scattering or Fresnel scattering. Now let me tell you what is Rayleigh scattering and Fresnel reflection. When a light pulse is sent into a fiber, a part of the light pulse runs into the microscopic particles inside the glass medium called dopants and gets absorbed and scattered in all the directions. This is called Rayleigh scattering. Some of the light rays may scatter back in opposite direction of the pulse, and that is called as backscattering. Fresnel reflection occurs due to sudden changes in density at the ends of the fibers, at fiber breaks, and sometimes at fiber splice points. OTDR consists of a laser diode source, as shown here, from which the pulses of light enters into the directional coupler. The directional coupler allows the light to travel in the specific direction. The sensor in the pin diode accepts the optical signals from the fiber, converts it into electrical signals, and passes those signals into the controller unit. The controller unit consists of A to D converter, that is analog to digital converter, microprocessor, then digital to analog converter. The controller is the brain of OTDR. It only tells the laser when to pulse and when to get the reflected light back. The major component of the controller section is a very accurate clock circuit, which is used for measuring the time difference between when the laser pulses and when the sensor detects the returning light. The time difference between the time at which the laser transmits a pulse and the sensor detects the returning light is called the round trip time. By multiplying this round trip pulse time by the speed of light in the fiber, the round trip distance can be calculated. The distance from the OTDR to this point is simply half the round trip distance. The controller samples the level measured by the sensor at regular time intervals and plots its data points. When all the data points are gathered together, we get a graph like this. It plots the information on the display screen. The display screen is a cathode tube, or it could be an LCD screen that allows the data points that make up the fiber splice and displays the OTDR setup conditions and measurements. Now let me tell you a few applications of OTDR. Using optical time domain reflectometer, the overall or end-to-end loss of system can be measured, and splice loss can also be measured, and it can measure reflectance or optical return loss, and it is used for locating fiber breaks and defects and to detect the sudden or gradual degradation of the fiber. These are the references I follow: Optical Fiber Communication by Gerd Kaiser and Optical Fiber Communication by John M. Senior, and these are the e-books. Thank you.